forgot to say this. I know Jude mentioned it briefly, but if you're interested in coming to the pastor's coffee today, we do have a few people that have signed up. If you'd like to be a member of the church, you got to come to that. But if you just want to know more about the church, I invite you to come anyhow. We meet at 5 o'clock, and it will be really good to see some of you there who call this your church home, but you still aren't members. So I'd love to have you there if you can come. So that's at 5 o'clock today. I want to invite you to have a few moments of true confession. So here's the questions. How many of you have ever engaged in an activity known as channel surfing? Raise your hand. How many of you don't know what that means? Okay. Well, we'll go on. How many of you have found that channel surfing changed your life for the better? Ah. Channel surfing is just, picture what it means. You just flick through the channels, trying to find something better. People who take time to study things like channel surfing tell us that habitual channel surfing has some negative effects. It decreases our ability to pay sustained attention, that is to learn. It also increases our sense of isolation and passivity. Now, the obvious question is this. If it sucks away so many hours of our life and gives so little back, why do we do it? The answer is, I think, it doesn't cost us anything. It's easy to do. There is no effort involved. In a world where channel surfing has become a national pastime, followers of Jesus need to be careful that we don't take a channel surfing attitude into our attitude about worship. Because worship always, always demands an investment. It takes a commitment to come to a service of worship. I mean, think about this. Some of you drive a long distance. It takes extra energy motivating children to get ready for church. I remember one time we served a church for 4 years, and we had 3 children at the time, and I had 2 churches. And the first service started at 9 o'clock, and we had to get to the first church was 4 miles away. The second church was about 7 miles away, and so I had to drop Cheryl off with the 3 kids at the church. The first church, even though that service started later because Sunday school was there. So we had dropped the kids off, had to go to this church. But in order to get to that second church, we had to get the kids ready for the first church, which means they had to get there early, which is always a lot of fun. And if you have to raise children to get to church, and I know how enjoyable that is. It takes commitment just to get dressed and to show up. Some of you park really close. Some of you park a little bit further away. In worship, we give the gift of concentrating sustained attention on God alone. And we seek to authentically bring God into the fullness of our emotional life. Worship always costs something. So I want to ask you to give God the costliest worship that you can this morning, because he deserves it, and I want to show you why. Isaiah chapter 6 begins with these words. In the year that King Uzziah died. Now, the prophet Isaiah begins this way for some specific reasons. Uzziah became king of Israel when he was 16 years old. We know that he was a military genius, he was a builder, he was a technological innovator, he was an economic wizard, and he was a spiritual leader. With the exceptions of Solomon and David, He is remembered as the most powerful king that Israel ever had. He reigned a long time. He reigned for 52 years. Now, to put that into context for today, think back how many people have had the office of president over the past 52 years. Here's the list. Nixon, Ford, Carter, Reagan, Bush Sr., Clinton, Bush Jr., Obama, Trump, and Biden. Now think about it. For most of the people at Israel at this time, Uzziah was the only king that they could remember. He was their anchor. He was a source of strength. He was a source of confidence for the nation. He was their king. And then he died. What do you do when Uzziah dies? What do you do when your anchor in life breaks loose and you're cut afloat? What do you do when you lose your job? What do you do when your money runs out? What do you do when a rock-solid relationship begins to shake? What do you do when everything you're counting on begins to unravel and there's no more safety net? What do you do? That was the question that was being asked by the people of Judah in the days of Isaiah. Every follower of Jesus has to ask the question, what will I do when the things that I place my trust in fall apart and let me down? Where will I look? Isaiah learned what to do. He turned his eyes from the temporary earthly throne of a man to the eternal throne of God. Uzziah is dead, but God is alive. And the throne of Judah is empty, but the throne of heaven is occupied. King of Judah is gone. God will never leave. And Isaiah needs to remember what we all need to learn, and that is there is one who is seated on the throne of heaven, and he reigns over the affairs of each one of us. Well, Isaiah sees God surrounded by angelic beings, and he points out that the seraph used two wings to cover their faces, and they're covering their faces because of the unspeakable holiness of God. And Isaiah also points out that these heavenly beings are covering their feet with another set of wings. And back in those days, feet were a sign of earthiness. And so covering them was a sign of honor and respect. R.C. Sproul helps us at this point. He suggests that in English we have many ways to emphasize things. If we want to get somebody's attention when we're writing, we can put words in capital letters, we can italicize, or we can use an exclamation point. In Hebrew, they didn't have those options. In ancient Hebrew, there were no vowels, little punctuation, no lowercase letters. Hebrew is just a run of consonants with little dots and spaces between words. The beginning of Isaiah chapter 6, if it was written in English, if according to Hebrew, it would read something like this. Or since they read from right to left, it would look like this. Big difference. Right? Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3 would read like this. So the main way that the Hebrew language emphasized something was repetition. We do the same thing. You ever have one of your kids who is feeling just a little bit left out when a sibling is getting more attention? Just like Jan in the episode of Brady Bunch. Remember Jan in Brady Bunch? She expresses her frustration. She goes, "Marsha, Marsha, Marsha." That's all I ever hear. Well, sometimes in the Bible, a word gets mentioned twice. But this is only used when something is very important and needed emphasis. Jesus would often say, if you remember, truly, truly, I say to you, or verily, verily, I say to you. So he repeated it twice. And so that was something that told us, this is really important. You need to listen to this. It's a way of getting attention. But on a handful of occasions, a word gets repeated three times in the Bible. And this elevates to what is said to ultimate importance. And only once in the Old Testament, which Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3, and in the New Testament, Revelation 4, 8, is an attribute of God elevated to this level of three times. It's interesting to note that God's never called loving, 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 or compassionate, 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 or peace, 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 or just, just, just. Nowhere in the Bible do we read anything like that at all. Only the holiness of God gets the three multiplied three times. Holy, holy, holy. Holiness is the gets to the core of who our God is. It's challenging to define exactly what holiness is. Most people think of moral purity when they try to define holiness. That's an important part, but it's not the core of holiness. The Hebrew word kadosh means separate or set apart. It's something or someone who was wholly other. W-H-O-L-L-Y, not H-O-L-Y, wholly apart. Imagine the most awe-inspiring moment in your life and take that sense of wonder, that sense of mystery and awe, and multiply it by infinity. Only then can you begin to get a glimpse of the effect that God's holiness has on a human being. God is wholly other. There is nothing, no one like him in all of creation. God is an eternally self-sufficient, burning, transcendent, brilliant, gifted, perfect being. He is holy, holy, holy. That's why the heavenly beings cry out, the whole earth is full of his glory. The whole earth cannot contain all of God's glory any more than a thimble can contain all of Niagara Falls. This is the God that we are called to worship. And true worship is always costly. It's the opposite of casual. When we understand the truth about worship, we no longer make casual commitments. We don't say, well, if I have time, I'll go to church. Or if it's convenient, I'll go to worship. Or if I like the style, or when I get around to it. We don't drift in and out of attention as if we're channel surfing. True worship means we do what the angels did. We come with our whole person. We carefully focus our thoughts and emotions on him. And we sing with all of our heart, even when we don't like the tune, because God deserves our undivided praise. We listen intently to the proclaimed word, even if the teaching style is not what we like, because we know that God wants to speak each time his word is opened. And we set aside everything that could distract us. And we strain with all of our strength to see the Lord seated on his throne. And we do all that we can to enter into the presence of God, and we stand in awe of his majestic glory. We respond to him with our voices, we respond to him with our bodies and our hearts and our lives and all that is in us. That's worship. And when we commit to worship, we purpose in our hearts to take every possible distraction and set it aside, because we're going to do the most important thing of all. We're going to worship the God who made us and loves us. When Isaiah sees the living, holy God, his first response is not excitement. He doesn't celebrate that he's been singled out for something special. He doesn't start thinking about how he can impress other people with his amazing spiritual experience. He says, whoa. Now that's a very important prophetic word, whoa. All through the prophets, the word whoa is a flag. Because a word of judgment is going to follow. What's unique and unprecedented about Isaiah's is that when he says woe, he's getting ready to pronounce judgment on himself. He says, woe is me, I'm ruined. And when Isaiah sees the holiness of God, it causes him to see the full extent of the darkness in his own being. He's shattered. He is ruined. The word ruined literally means disintegrated. And if you break that word down, disintegrated, you have integer. What's an integer? It's one. And when you break apart, he says, I am ruined. I am disintegrated. That one is broken apart. It's no longer complete. And that sight almost destroys him. And then the angel takes a live coal from the altar, and the coal touches his lips, one of the most sensitive parts of the human body. Can you imagine what it would have been like to have someone approach your mouth with a live coal? Think about that. Do you think he would just stand there? The point is this. There is real pain, there is real sting to the process of confession and repentance. Some people think grace and forgiveness means that we'll never feel pain over things that they've done wrong, because God has to forgive us. The goal of God's grace is not primarily to spare us from pain. It's to redeem our character. Experiencing remorse and sorrow over our sin is an important part of this process. I want you to understand this. It's what we say mostly that reveals the fallenness of our hearts. Confession always has a sting to it. In a sense, Isaiah has hit rock bottom. When he says, woe is me, I'm ruined, it's the beginning of healing. It's his first step towards grace. And when he hits bottom, he begins to look up, but there's still pain. I mean, imagine a coal hitting your lips, and imagine the smell of burnt flesh, and imagine the puckering and the intense pain that would come from having something that hot hit your lips. James chapter 4, verse 7 says, wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your mourning, laughter to mourning, and your joy to gloom. Look at the verbs in the middle. Grieve, wail, mourn. That's a command. It's not neurotic guilt. This is to enter deeply into God's sorrow over sin until we're so strongly motivated to make it right, to be healed. Then, and that will pay whatever price to get there. Christians used to speak about the gift of tears. And they would even ask God to give them tears and a broken heart. And that deep desire was that they would be led to a place of authentic repentance that led to cleansing. You've heard that phrase, that tears cleanse the heart. So I'd like to kind of do that, enter into a time of private confession. And I'm going to ask you to ask God to show each of you and me what we need to see in ourselves. Maybe there's an attitude of jealousy. judgment or anger that God wants to speak to you about. Maybe you're driven by the wrong things. Maybe there's something that you did that's hurt another person and it needs to be set right. Maybe you battle with a mouth that lies or slanders or gossips. It's very important that you hear these words. Your guilt is taken away. Your sin is atoned for. Because what was promised to Isaiah was fulfilled by Jesus on the cross. So, I know this is simple, but I'd like you to do this anyhow. I want you to turn to your neighbor and softly tell that person, Jesus paid the price for my sin. God does not cleanse Isaiah just for his own sake. God has a calling. And he says, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Why does God ask this? He asks the question so that Isaiah can freely choose to go. Isaiah says, here I am, send me. Spiritually authentic worship always ends with a heart that is willing to follow God. Worship is never, ever about having an intense emotional experience. It's never simply about how I feel when everything is done and when I walk out those doors. It's always about focusing heart and mind and body and soul on God. Worship is costly, and part of the cost is a submitted life. Later on in the book of Isaiah, we get more insight into the call of Isaiah. Now, I want you to listen to these words. He says, it is too small a thing for you to be my servant to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I've kept. I'll also make you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring my salvation to the ends of the earth. And up to this point, God's people considered those who belong to the nations as they're excluded from God's love and God's plan. Foreigners were not thought to be welcome. Eunuchs, those with deformities, they were excluded. And many others were not invited. But now everything is going to change because everyone will be welcome. In Acts chapter 8, we read about Philip's encounter with an Ethiopian eunuch. I want you to read that maybe when you get home. Acts chapter 8. This eunuch was excluded from Israel on multiple levels. And God tells Philip, I want this man to be included in my people. Now, here's a bonus question, all right? When Philip met this man, this eunuch was reading from a book in the Old Testament. What book was he reading? Isaiah. It was Isaiah. And in that moment, through faith in Jesus, this foreign eunuch became part of God's family. Isaiah chapter 56 goes like this. And foreigners who bind themselves to the Lord will serve him, to love the name of the Lord and to worship him. All who keep the Sabbath without desecrating it and hold fast to my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and will give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Does that last phrase, by the way, sound something familiar that maybe Jesus said to the people who were the money changers? My house will be called a house of prayer. So I want you to know that this chancel rail is open for prayer. And I urge you not to be concerned about what people think if you want to come to the chancel rail to pray. This is a time for you to realize the forgiveness of God, to be made holy or to renew what was once done in your life. This is a time of confession just between you and God. Yes, you can pray in your seat. But I also want you to know the chancel rail is open if you'd like to come up here and pray. So I'm going to say, let's pray and give you a moment if you want to do that. And then I'm going to close in prayer, but you're welcome to stay here as long as you want. Because this place is a house of prayer for all people. Let's pray. Father, in your house, we can feel especially close to you. And so this morning, we ask that you'd forgive us. Perhaps for the lackadaisical attitude we've had towards worship. Perhaps for the times that we have been estranged from a brother or sister. And we ask that you'd forgive us, but you also would send us out, knowing that we're forgiven. And even though we don't have live coals, we do ask that you would take that which is sinful in our lives and burn it away. Help us to draw close to you, to realize what Jesus has done for us, the difference that he makes, the promise that we have to live with him and for him. This is our prayer. And may we go realizing the great love of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit, and the sacrifice of Jesus, his Son, this day and always. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. See you next week.
Take your box.